In this small series of lectures, we are going to discuss the methods employed in making a clinical diagnosis. I give a little stress on clinical because that is the science and the art which is fast getting disappeared, almost going to become extinct in a couple of years maybe. The art of clinical medicine depends upon two main pillars, and those are, number one, a very good history taking, and number two, a very good clinical examination. If you just look at a small clinic, what patients come there for? About 95% patients will come with some complaint. That is, something is wrong with their body and they have come with that complaint. For example, pain brings the patient to the doctor most often. Pain may be present in the joints, pain in the back, or it may be a chest pain, it may be a pain in the abdomen, or headache, toothache, and many other different types of pains and aches bring the patient to the doctor. Another very important symptom is fever. In other words, elevation of body temperature. When the body feels hot, you touch the person, person is hot. And that is what brings the patient to us, alteration in body temperature. And then alteration in any function, alteration in bowel function, for example, patient is having vomiting, patient is having loose motions or constipation, there is alteration in the bowel function. There can be alteration in the bladder function. There is too much urine, too frequent urination, or passing less urine. Or there may be alteration in any other function, like the sexual function, like the cardiac function, like the pulmonary function, and any of these things can bring the patient to the doctor when the patient presents with a bodily complaint of either pain, fever, alteration in any function, vomiting, loose motion, breathlessness, feeling of restlessness, ghabrahat, as it is known as most often in Hindi, sexual function, reproductive function. Some people come to the doctor because the couple has no issues, and these are all the bodily complaints. 95% of the patients come with the complaint. Then what the other persons come for? Sometimes patients come because they have a hidden fear. Say, for example, some people may express it, some people may not express it, but they may have a hidden fear inside. Some people will say, doctor, one of my neighbors died suddenly. He was a hale and hearty person till about 2 days back. I don't know what happened, but he died suddenly. And the fear is, could it happen to me as well? And that fear leads the person to seek medical attention. The third group, which is a small group but is rapidly expanding these days, because the current fashion is, the laboratory people will advertise, we do the whole body testing for just ₹2,200 only, and the person gets attracted. Okay, let me get myself checked up, a full checkup. Only for ₹2,200 is very lucrative offer. What do? They will take your blood sample and analyze everything from hemoglobin, total differential count, blood sugar, urea, creatinine, cholesterol, phalana, dhimaka, everything. And then they come out with a report of several pages. And when the patient sees, there are some features which are highlighted by the computer. Say, for example, the blood sugar level should have been not more than 126. And if it is 127, the computer will highlight it. And the person gets panicky. And the person comes to the doctor. Oh, doctor, I got my whole body checkup done. And see, look at it. Oh, what abnormal reports I got. In all these three types of patients coming to you, the approach is similar. And what is the approach? The approach is we have to take a good history, perform a good clinical examination, and then plan some investigations to reinforce our impressions that are formed during history taking and during the clinical examination. If we follow these methods, number one, 80% of the diagnoses are clear with only history and clinical examination. The number of investigations that is required is reduced, the expenses are reduced, and confidence increases. Both the confidence of the patient in the doctor and the confidence of the doctor in himself, both these things improve, and the therapy becomes more successful if the diagnosis has been made properly. Now, coming to history taking. Although in the books of clinical methods, the history has been divided into history of present illness, personal history, past history, menstrual history, obstetric history, and so on and so forth, but it should come like a smoothly flowing river, one after the other. Casually, you can ask the patient more personal questions also, but in the beginning, one must note down the presenting complaint, because that is what the patient has come to you for. Presenting complaint, pain, where it is, how intense is it, what factors aggravate it, what factors relieve it. At the end of the lecture, I will give you a few mnemonics also to remember what questions you need to ask when the person comes with a pain, what questions you have to ask when the person comes with a fever, and so on and so forth. In the background, on the backside of your head somewhere, there is a great storage of data, and in the background of that data, you need to ask the various questions to the patient so that the cause of that particular symptom can be pinpointed. I will give a few examples. For example, the patient comes with a pain. So, what is the location? The location is in the epigastric region. What is the duration? Yes, this is a very tricky question, and patients, I don't know why, they try to trick the answer. They try to sideline. They try to divert your attention. A very simple question about duration: for how long is it there? Does not elicit an accurate, to the point response. When we come across patients who speak in Hindi, they will say, "Kafi time ho gaya." Now this kafi time leads you to nowhere, because kafi time could be 20 minutes. If you ask a patient who is sitting in the waiting room, "Yes, sir, how long have you been sitting here?" He will say, "Kafi time ho gaya." If you ask a patient, "How long you have this pain in abdomen?" He will also say, "Sir, kafi time ho gaya." His kafi time is different. Another patient's kafi time is different. And therefore, every clinician has to make great efforts to elicit the correct response for how long has it been present, because there is a great difference. If the pain is there only for last half an hour and the patient has come to you, that shows that the intensity is really great. It disturbed the patient. He could not perform his normal function, what he was doing at that time, and the pain was intense enough to bring him to the doctor immediately. But at the same time, if the patient says the pain has been here for the last about 6 or 7 days, that itself shows that it has not been so intense. The patient could tolerate it well, the patient could work, the patient could roam about having the pain there, and therefore these two pains may differ in their origin and may also differ in what happens next in their prognosis. So there is a great importance given to the duration of symptoms present, and I must stress it very often that a clinician should make great effort to elicit the correct response. A small story. Once upon a time, there was a movement in the country that was led by the Reverend Lal Krishna Advani. And he used to say, Babri Masjid was not here since the beginning. It was made only very recently. Then somebody asked, precisely when the Babri Masjid was made? He said, only about 450 years back. So 450 years span is just recent. So what is not recent then? He said, in a country's history of culture, it ranges between 5 to 10,000 years. And compared to that period, the period of 450 years is just recently. Okay, so everything is relative. I was telling you that on the backside, there is a great stored data about each and every disease which you can read in the books of textbooks of medicine. For example, if you read dengue fever occurs almost every year in India. We know it is spread by mosquitoes. It is caused by a virus which is of several types, DEN, DEN 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And dengue fever is associated with a reduction in the platelets. About 10 per 1000 patients will have dengue hemorrhagic fever, in which the platelet counts go so low that bleeding can occur from the teeth, gums, and bleeding can occur from the nose, in the urine, and elsewhere. And that is known as the dengue hemorrhagic fever. Out of those 10, that means out of 1000 patients, one patient goes in a shock, which is known as DHF with shock. And for this reason, when this background information is stored inside you, you have to ask questions. If the patient has fever, is there body ache? Is there headache? Are you vomiting? And if at all questions are answered in the positive, that is, yes, doctor, I have fever, there is body ache, backache, and headache, you can ask, is there any bleeding from the gums or nose? And if the patient says, yes, yesterday I noticed a little bleeding from my nose, immediately you know clinically, without even testing the blood, that there must be a deficiency of platelets that has given rise to this nosebleed or a gum bleed. So the vast stored knowledge about different diseases, their ways of presentation, their different complications, and the ways of presentation of the complications, in the light of all these, you can of course modulate and modify the questions that you ask the patient. Then suppose suddenly you discover something. You are talking to the patient, you discover there is a big lump over here in the side of the neck. Even if the patient does not complain of it, you need to point out, there is a lump in your neck. Have you ever noticed it? For how long have you noticed? Does it cause pain? Does it move from side to side? Does it bulge when you swallow? Does it bulge when you blow on something? And all these questions can come up and into your mind if you have a vast knowledge of the conditions that could exist in this region. It can be a lymph node, or it could be a pharyngeal pouch, or maybe something else. It may be a dilated blood vessels. If you blow something, the veins will dilate. If I speak a long sentence, my neck veins can dilate, and you can have a look at them. Neck veins dilate. When I sing a lambitan, then also the neck veins will become wider and dilated. So history taking is a great art, which of course can be achieved only through a prolonged practice. Take history. Our teachers, always when they heard our histories, they were in a position, they were able to point out what mistakes did we make. There was a lady who used to have complaint of pain in the abdomen. Those were the days when there was no ultrasound available with us. We referred that lady to Delhi, and they did every possible investigation, and ultimately she was operated upon. The operating surgeon could remove a cyst, And then it was ultimately diagnosed that it was a hydatid cyst. Later on, some house person started asking her, "Do you have pet dog in your house?" She said, "Yes, it's very dear to me. It sleeps in my bed." And then suddenly the whole thing was revealed that the hydatid cyst had come through this dog. Had someone taken this history earlier in the course, probably the diagnosis could have been made much earlier. And this goes on almost every day, because somewhere or the other, our histories lack in accuracy and also in their extent. So please mind, please keep it an eye that your histories should be as detailed as possible. Then something comes up in the patient's life, and suppose, for example, a patient is detected to have a high blood sugar, then again you have to go back to the history taking and ask the patient why your blood sugar is high. Were your parents diabetic? At what age did they develop diabetes? And what is your age? Usually we see that progressively, that means generation after generation, the age of onset of diabetes is reduced. Somebody's father developed diabetes at the age of 60. This person develops diabetes at the age of 45 only. This is a common observation that we see in the clinics. Once the history of presenting illness is over, you need to ask about the past history, particularly if the patient has undergone some prolonged illness, if the patient has had to get hospitalized, if there was an operation, if there was an injury. All these things need to be mentioned in the past history. If they are negative, one must mention in the negative. There is no history of accident, no history of operation like that. And then gradually proceed to taking the personal history. Is the person addict to smoking? Does he take alcohol? And such other questions which may need a little privacy should be asked with great confidence. And when the patient develops confidence in the doctor, then he reveals the truth and the illness is apparent and it is very clear and the diagnosis is made very easily. In case of female patients, their menstrual history and their obstetric history must be obtained. I will give you just an example. There was a lady who came to the emergency department of BHL when I was working there as a assistant CMO. I was actually a physician posted in the Department of Medicine, and I was called in on an emergency basis. And when I reached there, there was one Dr. Dushya who said, "Doctor, there is a volleyball case." I said, "What do you mean by volleyball case?" "Volleyball case is the one in which the surgeons will push the patient towards the physicians and the physicians will push the patient towards the surgeons. Ultimately, I don't know who wins and whose case it is, because everyone wants to show off the responsibility to someone else." Okay, I reached the bedside of the patient. The whole abdomen was swollen. There was a tube put in the nasal aperture, nasogastric tube, and then I started asking, "Okay, what happened?" "Sir, the abdomen is getting distended progressively." "For how long?" Fortunately, they said accurately, "It is there for 4 days. The patient was hospitalized in some hospital. They had put in the nasogastric tube. Nothing was coming out. Still, intravenous fluid was going on. The patient was not passing motion because she was not allowed any food. But they had forgotten to take a menstrual and obstetric history." What was the obstetric history? The patient had no child. Her married life was about 11 years. She had no issue. She probably never became pregnant. And even now, the menstrual period was a little delayed. How much delayed? About 1 month. So the menstrual period occurred in 2 months this time. And it was a slightly heavier period. That's what all they had to present. But then A clinician's mind should run quickly. What must have happened? Had she become pregnant in the intervening days? Probably yes. But now what? Now the bleeding is there, so she is not pregnant. Or had she been pregnant, probably she has aborted. But a wise clinician will also consider the possibility of a tubal abortion. And this is exactly what I did. I took the history. I wrote a big note. The patient had missed her last period and now she is having menstruation. Was she pregnant? Was it a tubal pregnancy? And lo, from suddenly being a volleyball case pushed between a physician and a surgeon, the case became belonging to an obstetrician and gynecologist. She was operated on the same day at 4 p.m. and it turned out to be a ruptured tubal pregnancy. Those were the days when we did not have ultrasound at our disposal. Even for ultrasound, we probably needed the patient to send to Saharanpur, maybe 100 and 150 kilometers away from the site. And there was no ultrasound machine in Haridwar at that time. It was only the clinical skill and clinical examination that saved the life of that patient, that made the diagnosis very accurate. And I still feel proud about that, of having diagnosed without any gadget like even a small ultrasound machine. So this is what happens when you take a very good history. 80% of the diagnoses are clear by simply taking a good history and performing a good clinical examination. So next we will move what a good clinical examination means. In every patient, you must take body weight. When the patient comes to the OPD, the body weight must be noted. Why? What are the uses? Number one, the drug dose has to be calculated according to the body weight. Even injection dose at times is needed to be calculated according to the body weight. If a patient comes with severe pain and I have to give him an injection of diclofenac, I don't give blindly 75 mg to everyone. I use the dosage schedule of 1 mg per kg. If the person weighs 75 kg, I will give the whole ampoule, that is 75 mg. If the person weighs only 37 kg, I will give half an ampoule. And so, in that proportion, in order to minimize adverse effects and maximize the efficiency of the drug, it has to be prescribed in the correct dose, milligram per kg dose. And therefore, this is the first reason why we should take weight of every patient. There has to be a weighing machine in every clinic. Then take temperature. Even if the patient is not complaining of fever, the temperature must be noted. In the clinical practice, I have found this thing very often. That some patients of fever are not aware of this fact. Okay, when you get fever, how do you know there is fever? Number one, the exhaled breath is hot. It's a very interesting thing to note that the philtrum area of the upper lip, this is very sensitive to temperature. My son Rohit, when he was only 4 years old, he discovered one thing. And then he came to me, "Oh, Papa, just look at me." He held a balloon in his hand, a small inflatable balloon, deflated balloon. And he said, "Papa, you just take it, apply it to your nose." I applied. "Is it cold?" "Yes." "Now stretch and apply." Stretch the balloon, apply it there. It becomes hot. Because the energy of the hand which is applied in pulling the rubber makes it hotter. How hot? Whatever may be the degree in centigrade or Fahrenheit, but this area of your philtrum of the nose and the upper lip, this is able to perceive even that heat. And therefore, if the person says, "I am feeling my breath to be hot at this area," he probably means he has fever. Now, apply the thermometer and you find, yes, the body temperature is elevated. But both these things have false positive and false negative phenomena. What false positive? At times when the patient feels that there is fever, but if you measure with a thermometer, the temperature is normal. At other times, the patients may be totally unaware that there is fever. I'll tell you an example. When I was working in BHL, someone came, "Doctor, I was feeling very restlessness and very curious sensation and didn't know why I had this thing. I went to one doctor and I got my ECG also done." I looked at the ECG. The ECG was normal. I said, "Okay, please sit down." I checked his temperature. He had fever of 101 degree. He was totally unaware that there was fever. And so are several people. And that is the reason why I say, whenever a patient comes to you with whatever complaint, restlessness, palpitation, breathlessness, weakness, lethargy, easy fatigability, make the patient sit down, apply a thermometer. It takes only 1 minute to record the temperature. And in that minute also, you can still utilize that 1 minute in counting the pulse or measuring the blood pressure, etc. So in 1 minute, you gather the information about temperature, pulse and blood pressure. And these three are very important and very valuable parameters. If these three are normal, you can take it for granted that nothing serious has happened to the patient. But if there is a great alteration in the values of these things, supposing a normal pulse rate is an average 72, or it may be 80 or 90, but definitely not beyond 100 or 110. But if any one parameter is altered to a great extent, it must lead you to search for other abnormalities, what has led to this particular clinical abnormality. If somebody has an increased pulse rate, there could be several causes. The person may be in dehydration, the person may be having fever, the person may be having a low BP, and the heart is trying to compensate for it by increasing the heart rate, and so on and so forth. At times, the heart rate becomes fast when the heart loses its rhythm. Normal rhythm is sinus rhythm, but when the heart becomes fibrillating heart, atrial fibrillation, maybe the heart rate may become very fast. Sometimes it may be paroxysmal atrial or supraventricular tachycardia, and that makes the heart rate very fast. And it is very important to note the heart rate very accurately. Fortunately, nowadays every intern keeps a small pulse oximeter in his pocket. You just apply the pulse oximeter, it will give you both readings, the oxygen saturation as well as the pulse rate. And there is now probably no need to just keep the... So, when you have noted the body weight and body temperature, move on to seeing the pulse. In the pulse, we have to count the pulse rate, which of course has to correlate with the heart rate. The pulse also tells you about the volume of pulse. And the volume of pulse increases in several conditions. It increases in presence of anemia, it increases in presence of beriberi, and it also increases in presence of thyrotoxicosis or a regurgitant aortic or mitral wall. So when you hold the patient's pulse, and if the pulse is throbbing, it is known as throbbing pulse. That pulse could be present in all these four conditions. Elevated pulse rate warns you. If there has been fever when you notice the temperature, it will probably correlate well with the fever. When the fever is high, the pulse rate is also high. When the fever comes down, the pulse rate also comes down. Elevated pulse rate is also found in dehydration, blood loss, fluid loss. Whatever causes the blood pressure to fall will cause the pulse to increase because the heart tends to compensate. A high pulse rate, which is persistent, would be present because of thyrotoxicosis or some thyroid disorders which result from viral infections, viral thyroiditis, and sometimes a fast pulse is also because of viral myocarditis, which is a dangerous condition. So pulse rate, pulse volume and character of the pulse tell you many things about the patient's health and his illness. then check the blood pressure. Blood pressure is very low when the patient has dehydration, fluid loss, blood loss, in cases of atrial fibrillation, in cases of paroxysmal atrial tachycardia, all these cases the blood pressure is low. But if the blood pressure is high, that is also to be noticed, because high blood pressure in the long run will give rise to complications such as congestive heart failure, or high blood pressure can give rise to a cerebral hemorrhage, rupture of aneurysm, etc. And therefore, blood pressure must be measured in each and every patient attending the outpatient department. And therefore, the blood pressure must be noted in each patient attending the outpatient department. Then after the blood pressure, check the person from top to bottom. What at the top? Look at the conjunctivae. Are they congested? Are they anemic? Look at the sclera by putting your finger on the eyelid and asking the patient to look down. If the sclera is yellow, jaundice. Look at the tongue. Is it pink or blue? If the tongue is pink, the patient is not anemic. If the tongue is white, the patient is anemic. If the tongue is blue, the patient is cyanosed, which is known as the central cyanosis, and central cyanosis is present in case of communication between the right and left side of the heart, perforated ventricular septum, ventricular septal defect, VSD as it is known as, or it may be present in cases of pulmonary diseases like chronic bronchitis cor pulmonale, when a long time smoker, you see, the smoker has blue lips, a smoker has blue tongue because of the cyanosis which is present almost all the time. So look for every sign of disease that could be present, then incline the patient to say 45 degrees and look at the neck veins. If the neck veins are seen above the clavicle when the patient reclines to 45 degrees, that means there is increase in the central venous pressure. Increase in the central venous pressure could be because of several reasons. There is congestive cardiac failure in which the central venous pressure increases and the neck veins become engorged and they appear full up to this place, even in inspiration, water expiration. Check for the liver, check for the edema. For edema, press over the shin of tibia with a thumb, give sustained pressure, then release and then palpate. If you give a sustained pressure, there is formation of a pit. We know it as a pitting edema. So we have seen from top to the toe, not in the toe but also in the fingers, you have to look at the nails, because the nails could be clubbed, the nails could be spoon-like, which we know as the coelonychia, which is interesting and very curious phenomenon occurring in the iron deficiency anemia. So today, this much for the history taking and clinical examination. We have covered the general examination. In the next lecture, we will see about the systemic examination.